Good morning, friends. I'm Srishti Jain, and today we are going to do another set of 5 questions of finance. Do watch the video till end so to have the understanding of every concept that we are going to discuss today. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel for more beneficial videos and regular updates. Today we are going to discuss 5 questions, and those questions relate to very important and interesting topics. So guys, I'll be stating the topics that we are going to discuss today. First is World Intellectual Property Organization. Second is Ways and Means Advances. Third is GST. Fourth is Bharat Bill Pay. And the last one is very interesting, that is the Social Stock Exchanges, which is proposed by Nirmala Sitharaman in Union Budget 2019. So now, starting with the first question for today. Now this question says that World Intellectual Property Organization is a UN agency charged with protecting intellectual property. Which of the following rights relating to the intellectual property rights is not covered by World Intellectual Property Organization? So now 4 options have been given to you related to the rights relating to the IP, that is intellectual property. So now for your understanding, let us first discuss that what intellectual property means. So IP is a category of property that includes intangible creations of the human intellect. There are many types of intellectual property like copyrights, trademarks, patents, trade secrets. So this is the intangible creation of the human intellect, as the word also suggests, the intellectual property rights. Let's first understand what is the function of WIPO, that is World Intellectual Property Organization, through an example, and then we'll have a detailed discussion about this in the next slide. So suppose you are an Indian resident and you have written a book, and if you feel that the copyright has been infringed or there is an infringement by a US resident, say B, so you can sue B as per the US laws, because US is also a part of WIPO and India is also a part of WIPO. In total, 192 countries are a part of WIPO, and therefore it is very helpful and very important organization of United Nations, because it protects the intellectual property if there is any infringement. Now moving to the next slide for detailed discussion. Now this organization is the Global Forum for Intellectual Property Services, Policy, Information and Cooperation. It was established to encourage creative activity to promote the protection of intellectual property throughout the world. So it is a self-funding agency of United Nations with 192 member states, and its mission is to lead the development of a balanced and effective international intellectual property system that enables innovation and creativity for the benefit of all. Now, what are its objectives? While discussing the definition, while discussing what this organization do, it is very clear that it promotes the protection of the intellectual property throughout the world through cooperation among states and in collaboration with any other international organization. It also ensures administrative cooperation among the unions. Now, this is the list that is very important, and we are going to discuss it now. So, till now we are saying intellectual property. Now, this list specifies that intellectual property includes the rights relating to. So relating to these, the intellectual property is being covered by this organization. First is literary, artistic and scientific works. Second is performances of the performing artist, phonograms and broadcasts, inventions in all fields of human endeavor. Notice the word all. Then we have scientific discoveries, industrial designs, trademarks, cervix marks, commercial names and protection against the unfair competition. So this is the list of the rights relating to the intellectual property covered by World Intellectual Property Organization. Now, after having a brief discussion on the working, on the objective and on the intellectual property rights, Let's move back to the question to answer it. First option says literary, artistic and scientific works. This is a part. Industrial designs also is a part. Protection against unfair competition is also a part. Inventions in selected fields of human endeavor. We have read it that it is all the fields of human endeavor and not selected. So the correct answer is option D. Now moving on to the next question for today. This question is really interesting relating to the ways and means advances. So let's read the question first. RBI acts as the banker to the state governments by agreement. When there is a temporary mismatch in the cash flow of the receipts and payments of the state governments, RBI makes WMA, that is ways and means advances. So on what basis normal and special WMAs are differentiated from each other? So now let's have a brief discussion on ways and means advances in the next slide so to be in a better position to answer this question. So this is a temporary loan facility provided by RBI to the center and state governments due to the temporary mismatches in the receipts and payments of the government. So this scheme was introduced in 1997 after putting an end to the 4-decade-old system of ad hoc treasury bills to finance a central government deficit. So when RBI gives WMAs to the government, state or central, it charges the interest rate for it as well. So the interest rate is currently charged at the repo rate. And when the WMA limit is crossed, the government takes recourse to overdrafts, which are not allowed beyond the 10 consecutive working days. And the interest rate on such overdraft is charged at 2% more than the repo rate. So there are two types of ways and means advances. First is normal and the other is special. Now what is the difference between these two? Let's see it. Now special WMA is extended against the collateral of the government securities held by the state government. So while taking the ways and means advances, the government keeps those securities as collateral. And after the exhaustion of the special WMA limit, the state government is provided a normal WMA limit. Now you must be thinking that what will be the limits of these WMAs? So RBI in consultation with the government of India has set the limits for WMA for the first half of the financial year 1920, that is from April to September at ₹75,000 crore. So now after having a brief discussion on this topic, let's move back to the question to answer it. So in the question, you have been asked the basis on which normal and special WMAs are differentiated from each other. So let's look at the options now. On the basis of the time period for which WMA is given to state governments. So we haven't read it. This is not true. On the basis of the collateral government securities provided by the state governments against the WMA. So yes, this is the answer, because in the special WMAs, collateral is there, while in the normal WMAs, there is no collateral. Third is on the basis of special treatment given to some states. This is also not true. And on the basis of amount given by way of WMA, that is if the amount exceeds a particular threshold limit, then that will be termed as special WMA. So this is also not true. So the correct answer is option B. Now, moving on to the next question, which is also very interesting. Now this question is, which of the following statements is not correct about GST? GST is goods and services tax. So GST is like a last point retail tax. It is to be collected at the point of sale. Second is GST abolished all the direct tax levied in India. Third is it was implemented from 1st July 2017 throughout the country. And the last one is that it unified the tax structure in India. So first, let's see the answer and then we'll have a brief discussion on direct tax and indirect tax and a brief discussion on GST as well. So the correct answer here is that GST abolished all the direct taxes levied in India. So let's see why in the next slide. Now guys, there are two types of taxes. The first is indirect tax and the second is direct tax. So in the direct tax, the liability and the burden to pay that tax falls on the same person. For example, when you pay your income tax, the liability to pay the tax on your income as well as the burden to pay that tax falls upon you. You cannot shift the burden of your tax to someone else. Whereas what happens in indirect tax? The liability and the burden falls on different people, because it is the liability of the seller to pay the tax, but the burden falls upon the consumer. You must have seen while buying any product that it is their MRP inclusive of all taxes. So what are those taxes? It includes indirect tax, and therefore this kind of tax can be shifted from the seller to the consumer. Now, talking about GST now, what GST is, it is a kind of indirect tax and it is a destination based tax. Now, what do you mean by destination based tax? For example, if a seller belongs to the state of Rajasthan and you reside in Delhi. So when A sells the goods to B and on those goods GST will be charged, so this GST will be collected by the Delhi government and not the Rajasthan government, because the ultimate consumption, the point of sale is Delhi, and as this is the destination based tax, so GST will be collected by the Delhi government. So this GST doesn't have any relation with the direct tax, because direct tax is still there, that is the income tax, and therefore our answer was that GST abolished all the direct taxes levied in India. Now, moving on to the next question for today, I hope that you have understood the concept of GST, that is a destination based tax, and the difference between the indirect and the direct tax. Now this question is, which among the following is the function of the working group on social stock exchange set up by SEBI under the chairmanship of Ishaat Hussain, the director of SBI Foundation? So four recommendations has been given, and you have to tell me that this working group which has been set up by SEBI gave which of the following recommendation. So first, let's see the concept of social stock exchange in the next slide. So in the Union Budget, of Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman proposed setting up the first of its kind of social stock exchange in India. Now it will function as a common platform and on lines of the major stock exchanges like NSE and BSE. The difference will be in the purpose, that is, it will not be a profit making, but it will be a social welfare stock exchange. It will focus on the social welfare. So you must be thinking that why the social stock exchanges? So India needs massive investments in the coming years to be able to meet the human development goals identified by the global bodies like United Nations. So this can't be done through government expenditure alone. Private enterprises working in the social sector also need to step up their activities. Currently, social enterprises are very active in India. However, they face challenges in raising funds. So one of the biggest hurdles they face is apparently the lack of trust from the common investors. So this social stock exchange will try to provide a platform where the investors would invest in social enterprises authorized by the exchange. And recently the SEBI has constituted a working group on social stock exchange under the chairmanship of Ishaat Hussain. So the working group made recommendations with respect to the possible structures and the mechanisms within the securities market domain to facilitate the raising of funds by social enterprises and voluntary organizations. So now, after discussing this new concept of social stock exchanges, let's move back to the question to answer it. So option D is the correct answer, because it says that it recommends the possible structure and mechanisms within the securities market domain to facilitate the raising of funds by social enterprises and voluntary organizations. So this exchange is basically meant for the social enterprises which face the hurdle from raising the funds by the investors because of the lack of trust. Now, these social enterprises will get authorization by the exchange, and therefore the investors could easily invest in these enterprises. Now, moving on to the next question for today and the last question for today. The question says, Bharat Bill Pay enables every citizen to pay their different bills under the same window. The unified ecosystem brings banks, non-banks, and online payment platforms under one roof as its official authorized units for bill connections. So the Bharat Bill Payment System is a Reserve Bank of India conceptualized system driven by. So the answer to this question is National Payments Corporation of India. And now we will be discussing some facts about Bharat Bill Pay, which has been conceptualized by Reserve Bank of India. Now, as we have already seen, that is a conceptualized system driven by National Payments Corporation of India, also known as NPCI. Recently, RBI expanded the scope of Bharat Bill Payment System to cover the repetitive bill payments, which may include school fees, insurance premium, and municipal taxes. But that still excludes prepaid recharges, and it has been specifically mentioned in the RBI circular. Currently, the facility of payment of recurring bills through BBPS is available only in the five segments. That is DTH, that is direct to home, electricity, gas, water, and telecom. So the expansion may be in these bill payments also. With this, we have completed our five questions for today. I hope that you like the session. Now, a very simple question for you guys is that do tell me the difference between VAT and GST. I'll be looking forward to your answers in the comment section below. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel, hit the bell icon, like the video. Thank you for watching the video.